So now we'll take a look at our first host, the L6. The L6 is a 1U 6-module host with an external I/O of 8 in and 8 out. The L6 has a dipped rear, which allows us to stack as many L6s on top of each other without the need for gaps. Each module inside the L6, as with any future host, is secured by a 2-button latching system. To release this, you have to press both buttons at the same time. To reinsert the module, you just put pressure on the front plate. This can be done by the unit on or off. Right, let's get into the detail. So there's a lot to cover, and we're going to begin with the signal flow. So we're just going to flip this thing around. We'll begin with the 6 mic and line XLR inputs, and then we also have 2 additional TRS line inputs that are assignable via the crosspoint. After that, we have an option card. This can either be analog out or it can be digital I/O. Moving on to the control section, we have both Ethernet and USB. The USB can also be used to create your own Bluetooth network by using a Bluetooth dongle, or it can be used to save files onto a USB storage device. The power section over here is for the primary AC input, which I'll go into how the power works a little bit later, but also has the backup DC mains, giving you a redundant power supply. Within all this I/O, there is additionally a passive audio bypass, meaning that if the unit loses power, your audio passes directly from input to output, maintaining the L6 as a show critical device without any audio drops. So now I've got audio into the L6, what happens next? Well, it travels straight from the rear of the unit into the module. And for that, we need to flip it back around. Let's get the lid off. So from here, we can now see the rest of the signal flow. So as I said, it travels from the rear of the unit into the module. Now, once it goes through the module, this could be a transformer balance part, or it could be any part that the manufacturer chooses for its signal flow. It then travels through the first stage of the module. From then, it goes into what we call the SEPIA mainframe. These are a bunch of generic analog stages. They're completely atonal, but they provide a supporting infrastructure that modules can use to reduce the amount of things that have to go inside the module. After it's gone through the mainframe, it can then enter into the crosspoint, which is under here. The crosspoint can route that signal from there to absolutely anywhere else. And with SEPIA patch, which we will explain more later, it can go to any other SEPIA frame as well. After it's entered this stage, it then re-enters that module if you do not route it elsewhere, and then goes into a second module stage. On the second module stage, again, it can go through whatever electronics are inside that module before entering the mainframe for the second time. This is what we call the SEPIA bridging signal flow, and is part of our unique design. Once it has gone through the mainframe for the second time, it then enters into the output section of the unit. This is where, whether it's digital or analog, it will then go through assignable outputs and then exit the L6 into whatever device you choose. Now let's talk about power. So as I mentioned before, we have a redundant power supply system, meaning if the primary system fails, there is a DC backup option. From here, we enter into our advanced power supply design. Here we have a number of pre-regulators, which mean that we can maximize efficiency, thermal performance, all while feeding 7 internal power supplies within the L6 host. The next power supply section here is our linear regulators for each module. This means modules can request the exact power they need, from plus or minus 3 volts to plus or minus 30 volts. From power to thermals. We took the thermal design extremely seriously when designing SEPIA, especially as it allowed us to lower the footprint of the modules themselves. It all starts here. 2 thermal bias springs on the module alignment that lift the module to the lid once the module is inserted. Here, heat is transferred onto a high conductive aluminium alloy and then travels back into this channel here. This channel is populated by heat sinks, an air gap, and temperature sensing fans that maintain an almost silent operation. So now we've gone through the L6, and if you need any more information, you can find it at carnot.com. But the most important bit about SEPIA is its modules. We have a single module and a dual module. Each module slot of a SEPIA system is 2 I/O, so this can also be stereo, and this can be 4 inputs and 4 outputs. Inside the modules are authentic analog components brought to you by their original manufacturers. They're able to achieve such a small footprint by utilizing all the aspects in SEPIA's design.